We'll be starting off with a 90-second introduction. Each candidate will be have an opportunity to state why they want to be an alderman and what their qualifications are. And we're going to start with Ms. Carreón.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for the League of Women Voters of Chicago for putting this together. And thank you to Alder Burns and the community residents for being here. My name is Yessenia Carreón, I'm a lifelong resident of the 10th Ward. In 2010, my now husband and I purchased a home on the east side where we now raise our 2 8-year-old twins. In 2006, I had the opportunity to intern for former Alderman John Pope, who's here, showing support. Thank you so much, Alderman. And I learned actually what an alderman's office does. That quickly led to 9 years of a career. And the passion that grew from working in the community was remarkable. I never even thought that I wanted to be involved in politics at all, but it was working with the community, working with the businesses, working with the organizations, what I fell in love with. In 2015, I started working with the South Chicago Chamber of Commerce, helping them reach out to constituents who were looking to open up businesses. Economic development is one of my main priorities, and that I want to work on if elected as your alderman. And I have the experience of being able to work with the chamber, helping businesses start from the planning to all the way to the groundbreaking. After that, I partnered with our neighborhood times, where we have helped highlight these businesses and these leaders and these organizations in the area. I want to continue to do that. I want to bring focus on our safety, which I believe is going to be answered when we build our economic development.
Keep it up.
Reason why I'm running for 10th Ward Alderman. Thank you so much.
Next, Mr. Chico.
My name is Chico. I'm a lifelong resident of the 10th Ward. I come from a family of public service. My grandfather was the president of Local 65. I saw steelworks in the 70s. My cousin Barry Chico held numerous positions in city government. I think I have the qualifications to be the next alderman. After college, I made a commitment to myself that I wanted to help people. I got an undergrad degree in political science, went back for my master's at DePaul University in public service. So I feel I have education to move forward. My first job was at United Way, helping families and communities in need. I transitioned into
child
welfare services. I worked at a children's
keep it up a little longer.
Just keep it up.
No, now you can take it down, but hold it up for a good while. Okay.
I moved on to law enforcement. 5.5 years to work on the sheriff's department. At that point in my life, I realized I wanted to do something more. I applied to the Chicago Police Department and came back home to the 4th District, which is just neighboring to where we're located right now. While in the 4th District, I saw the needs of the community. I got involved more. I became a board member of the Hunters Bulldogs. I've been a city member for the last 2 years. I ran for local school council 4 years ago, where I still sit on the board until this day. I want to speak to the people of Allgale Gardens. We have been disinvested for too many years. CTA, CHA, a food desert. When I'm old, that will stop on day one.
Ms. Guajardo.
Hello, everyone. Ana Guajardo, originally from the Bush community, 2 miles away from here. My parents are immigrants from Mexico. My father was a steel worker. I'm a veteran myself. I grew up in the south side of Chicago community in the 10th Ward, a community that has been disinvested for many years. I went to Chicago State University to get my undergrad in political science, University of Minnesota, my master's, and currently I'm a PhD student at Loyola University. The reason I'm running for alderwoman is I have seen here in the 10th Ward, and I'm glad that Alder Gardens is now part of the 10th Ward, so we can work together to lift up Alder Gardens as well. But I have seen how disinvestment our communities have been for so many years, how we constantly have to fight for the crumbs that are given to us from City Hall, from the state. And it's unfortunate that as communities of color, we continue to be disinvested and not enough resources come to our communities. I'm a former SEIU organizer, where I organize workers unions to form workers to unit, form a union. I created a co-funded a not-for-profit advocating for worker rights issues in the 10th Ward, where we have recovered millions of dollars in wages. Alder Gardens, like the remaining of the 10th Ward, has been a community that has been abandoned for so many years. And I would love, as and your future alderwoman to be able to work together to ensure that we lift up not just the other side of 94 Highway, but also this part of the community, because as an entire community, it's important for us to advocate and work together so we can lift up each other and be able to advocate and resource for our resources in our community. Thank you.
Mr. Sanchez.
Good afternoon. My name is Oscar Sanchez, and I'm running to be your next 10th Ward Alder person because I want to strengthen this community. And this can only be done by having real opportunity and investment. We talk about disfranchisement, but let's be honest. I risked my life for 30 days going on a hunger strike because the life expectancy between the north side and south side is 30 years, and it is not acceptable. During this pandemic, I was on the front lines making sure we had volunteers at food pantries. 200 people at food pantries? That's a lot. But then it turned to 800. We made sure people were fed and informed about COVID. And we're here today to talk to Alkill Gardens because you're a part of the 10th Ward. But let's be honest, did Alkill Gardens have a choice? Were there input about what you wanted to be a part of? What community? Who you want your representative to be? Because a representative to me is someone who understands you, has the same frustration as you, is going to work hard to make sure we listen and understand the issues of not having an environment for food, education, safety, youth programming. These are the real issues. And we have to be honest that people are suffering and people are dying. And the urgent things we can do today, taking advantage of funding and approaches to make sure we have safe, healthy, thriving communities for everyone. Thank you.
Ms. Venegas.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jessica Venegas. I just want to quickly thank everyone who put this together and Alva hosting this. And I actually want to welcome Alva Burns to our town board. I've been volunteering with communities all my life since I've been a teenager, with the parks, districts, and as I grew older, I started volunteering with various organizations such as the Eastside Chamber of Commerce. It's always been part of my blood to give back to the community. I became a police officer, been a police officer for 16 years. With that police experience, I've not only learned about solving crimes or by apprehending criminals, but I've also learned about assisting victims finding resources for themselves and their traumas. I'm also an attorney. I have a law practice on the east side. As an attorney, I have the skill set to navigate the legal system so that I can advocate for our communities. And that I'm the whole town board trying to advocate for the resources that we need for our communities. I want to give back to our community. I have the experience to address the crime. I have the experience to navigate through the system.
For the first question, each candidate will have 45 seconds to respond. I'll read the question once, and if any candidate would like to have it reread, just indicate to me. The rereading will not cut into your response time. The first question is, what strategies do you support for reducing violent crime in the city and in the ward? 45 seconds, and we start with Mr. Chico.
We need a short-term and long-term approach. Long-term, community centers. I envision opening up our school after hours, having programming for our youth and our families to connect them with resources they so desperately need, to get them off the streets and put their mind to other use. Short-term, which is what people want to know right now, what are you going to do today with the carjackings, everything else? Number one, be integrity. If we do not have any integrity, nothing else matters. Number two, we know we're short manpower. We need our extra bodies, our tactical or plain clothes officers. They need to be assigned to 10th Ward beats immediately, and I'm hoping that will happen. Three, and it includes all Gelt Gardens, Eastside Highway, Street Border, outside municipalities, Indiana, Riverdale. We need to strengthen our relationship with those communities so when they commit a crime here, they don't jump the border and get away from it.
Ms. Guajardo.
Several things. Some of the first things, as I've been door knocking for the last few weeks, I've been hearing a lot in terms of the crime rate, not just on the other side of the ward, but also in Aldermanic Gardens need to bring back the BCOPs. We need to, there's two districts. We have the fourth district, you have the fifth district. Public safety is so important. We need to build a relationship with our police officers and make sure that we're able to communicate with each other and that we build trust. We need to make sure that we also, I mean, sometimes the issue of public safety has to do with jobs. How do we provide jobs for our community so they can ensure that they have a livable wage and this is not the, this is the primary concern. This is the speed thing with the 40 seconds. We have to ensure that we invest in resources in our community. For example, as mentioned, after school programs, let's bring in these programs where our youth are involved. Let's make sure that we are able to invest in other resources in our community so we can ensure that our people remain active.
Mr. Sanchez.
Northwestern did a study that we can reduce crime by 50% in 18 months by making sure we have community outreach, talking to our communities about the resources they need. Alongside this workforce development, right now with the Chicago community, we have the Chicago Recovery Plan that has over $1 billion available to communities just like ours right now to make sure that we can support small business owners and entrepreneurs alongside the Climate Equity Jobs Act to bring good paying union jobs here. Alongside this, when it comes to actually solving things at the root issue, it's about investment and looking at how we can reduce crime even further by making sure that we have the education, counseling, and that's why we support treatment, not trauma, alongside working for empowering communities for public safety to build a relationship with our fourth district. Thank you.
Ms. Venegas.
Expressed during the question. For this next question, I'm combining a couple of questions that we've gotten from audience members. What is each candidate's plan to ensure the gardens have access to the alderman's office? Please be specific, and how will you help the people in Altgeld Gardens? For this question, the first person will be Ms. Guajardo. 45 seconds.
The first thing is we need to make sure that we have a satellite out. There's also the issue of public transportation. There is no public transportation that takes you from this part of the community to the other side of the community on 94. So making sure that we talk to City Hall, bring in resources so we can have those two offices set up in both communities. Also, it's important for us to make sure that we're communicating in terms of the different issues that the community should be receiving. So again, just reinforcing, making sure that we have communication with both parts of the community so we can provide those access to the resources that are important.
Mr. Sanchez.
For me, I think the answer is having a satellite office here, but let's also go further. Let's make sure we have a satellite office in our public libraries here in this community and all the other communities where there are libraries to make sure that there's also childcare, to make sure that we're actually supporting our parents to be able to come to the office and get the resources they need. Alongside this, making sure that we have available hours from virtual time as well, if you can have access. It's about building these relationships. For me, Elk Hill Garden is not a place to just be reading relationships right here, right now, but it's somewhere, this is my third time being in this facility, advocating for a grocery store alongside you all. So for me, it's about the relationships we have built before this election and the relationships we're going to continue building afterwards. And more specifically, right now, it's also making sure you're part of the decisions being made in this community that impact your lives. Thank you.
This is Venegas.
Ensure that we create a department of gun violence. We need to ensure that we also look at the environmental impacts and how lead also is a poison for our minds, and addressing lead pipelines today alongside all our trauma that we're facing in our community.
Ms. Venegas.
So, I absolutely want my mental health facilities, something that I spoke briefly about to some of the other answers. I know there's a Post and Wellness Center in the South Chicago area, and I would want to work with a facility like that, or find other facilities that are already existing, and work with them to try to have them get other locations and build other locations where we actually need them. We definitely make sure we check the research, see where we need them, try to advocate to get those facilities to build where we need them. There's a lot of vacant lots that we have near the areas that they're needed in, so we would work on coordinating and combining all of that.
Ms. Carreón.
Absolutely. I mean, our mental health situation is not the greatest, and I would love to be able to bring more resources here to our area. With the Red Line expansion, I do have hope that our business district will grow along with services like mental health. Right now, as a member of Our Neighborhood Times, we are partnered with Tommy Talks, a gentleman that put in a not-for-profit organization that mainly focuses highly on mental health when it comes to men, because it's very, very low, not really spoken about, and we will make sure to continue bringing resources like that, programs and workshops in the area here regularly, and make sure that there's funding available for his workshops that'll be free for the community.
Mr. Chico.
So I have worked at the largest mental health facility in the state, the Cook County Jail. And let me tell you, what I saw there was unacceptable. And then come to CPD, I would see those same inmates now on the street. What help did they get? Where do they even know where to go? It's about mobility and bringing the services to them, whether it be in the police departments or in public housing. We need to bring the services to them so we can contribute they need and stay off the path of recklessness.
Ms. Guajardo.
Studies have been made in the past that show in the zip code 60617, 60633, not even including our gardens, there's only one mental health person in that community that's licensed. We need to reallocate the funding that comes from the City of Chicago to make sure that we bring in the resources to our community. We also could look into the school. How do we ensure that the schools have the funding that they can have school counselors that can be available for the children and not limit, because many of these schools are limited in how many services they can provide, how many children they can see. We need to also make sure that we provide the education for folks who are able to become mental health experts, provide them the resources that they can further their education and be hired by these mental health facilities. But very importantly, I also want to share that my daughter's friend, a few weeks ago, had a bullet pass her head. Imagine the trauma that our children are facing every day. So
that's a hard one to ring a bell on.
Next question, 45 seconds for each candidate. This has to do with the subject of food desert. Currently, there are no grocery stores or even convenience stores in the vicinity.
Wow.
In fact, the neighborhood is lacking many, many goods and services. What do you propose to do to remedy this situation? Again, each candidate will have 45 seconds. I know it's very short. You will have an opportunity at the end in your closing statement to address any matters that you feel that you'd like to go further in detail on. This question first will go to Ms. Venegas.
So I have heard the concerns about this here, there being a food desert here. It's definitely something that we've been looking at to try to address, just like all the resources that you guys need, just like we spoke about with you on board. We want to make sure that we secure businesses and give incentives so that we can have people building businesses nearby so that they you guys no longer have that food desert. In the meantime, as I understand, you guys do have transportation to other grocery stores. I know that's not the final solution, but I would advocate and make sure that I work with CHA to make sure that you at least continue that. That resource until we can actually find a way to get you guys a grocery store and other resources that you need.
Next, Ms. Carreón.
So yeah, the food desert situation is a huge problem. I do have hopes, like I mentioned before, that with the Red Line extension, that's going to change. That's going to bring interest of the developers here in the area, bringing many businesses, especially around the stop, the 130th stop, where they're going to want to put businesses there, like supermarkets or coffee shops or, it's businesses that people that get off the train, they're going to want to be able to access. Not only that, but we need to start looking at reaching out to developers and educating them on what we have to offer. We have land here. We have services like the TIF program that we need to educate them about that. They can take advantage of the TIF funds or the enterprise zone or, in South Chicago, the SSA program. So these are the kind of programs that we need to start reaching out to developers using those as incentives to come to our town.
Mr. Chico.
We can't wait for Save a Lot to come open. We need to do something right now. It takes three buses to get to Walmart to have access to healthy food. That's almost criminal. So what we need to do, this falls on the feet of CTA. Get them involved, get more transportation out here for the quality to Southside residents. That's what we're going to do.
Ms. Guajardo.
So several years ago, Chico and I grocery store in Alder Garden. We need to rezone that area so we can open up a grocery store here in the community. Last week I was talking to two community residents who are business owners. If you can rezone and make that area residential, if you can rezone into commercial and have the businesses, because you have many people with the ability to be able to have their own space and their own business in this community. This is how we lift this up. So we start with the rezoning to make sure and provide the resources, whether it's a neighborhood opportunity fund, whether it's a Chicago recovery, where I sit on the council, to make sure that we can invest in this part of the community, but to start with the local residents. And it could be through the worker co-op, like we have incubated with the organization that I co-founded, two worker co-ops where we start up businesses from people in the community. And that's something that we can also do here in Alder Garden.
Mr. Sanchez.
When it comes to the grocery stores coming here, the community members must have a decision on what it is. When I came here for the meetings, when it came to Save a Lot, nobody wants Save a Lot. You need fresh, quality produce. And what's better way to do this? And this is something that I said on the doors, knocking and getting to know you all. Why don't we help develop land here and create jobs for youth to be farming, like urban growers in South Chicago, which has been successful in having a farmer's market. Why don't we create relationships with those types of programs to actually bring the food here instead of always us having to travel to get our needs met somewhere else? And most importantly, it's also about, why don't does the community own the grocery store themselves? Like in the North Side, happening in the 48th Ward, they're making 2,000 individuals be able to put in money themselves and operate their own grocery store. That's what we can be doing right now, today.
Why everything got to be wrapped around gangbanging?
All those against, please raise your hand. All those undecided or wishing to discuss further, raise your hand. Next question, yes or no. Would you be willing to have meetings with community groups and residents of the ward to discuss spending the ward's discretionary funds? Those are sometimes known as menu funds. Would you be in favor of meeting with community groups in the ward about the spending of those funds? Yes, please raise your hand. That's everyone. Next, do you support a tuition-free system for community colleges? you support a tuition-free system for community colleges? Yes, please raise your hand. And a final yes-no question. The city of Chicago used to have a Department of the Environment, and we haven't had one for over 10 years. There's a broad range of environmental issues that are divided among different departments. Do you support reestablishing the Department of the Environment? Yes, please raise your hand. Let me just go back over that. We have a request for clarification. Over 10 years ago, the city got rid of the Department of the Environment. And since then, responsibilities for environmental issues have been divided up among several departments. Are you in favor of setting up a Department of the Environment and putting all those issues within one department again? If yes, please raise your hand. Thank you. We're going to move on to our 45-second questions. This next question, 45 seconds. Chicago's 50 aldermen don't have obvious power over city schools. They don't choose who sits on the education board. They don't pick the schools chief. They don't have any say over closing of schools. They don't control budgets, contracts, or personnel issues. How can you, as a concerned alderman, still have a positive impact on the quality of schools in your ward? That's 45 seconds. First will be Mr. Chico.
Well, as a member of the LSC, we want to encourage people to run. We had our many people run for LSC of Washington High School. That's unacceptable. We're making decisions about the education of our youth. Number two, the aldermen should be showing up at the LSC meetings. How about that? And number three, meet with the principals on a monthly basis to get an understanding, a deeper understanding of what's going on.
And I apologize, it went out of order.
Yeah. Carry on.
Chicago's 50 aldermen don't have obvious power over city schools. They don't choose who sits on the education board. They don't pick the schools chief, and they don't have any say over closing schools. They also don't control budgets, contracts, or personnel issues. How can you, as a concerned alderman, still have a positive impact on the quality of schools in this ward? Ms. Carreón.
As Pete mentioned, I do believe that the aldermen should be hands-on as far as being part of the LSE, being part of going to the school meetings and sitting down with the teacher and principal. When I was working for Alden Jump Hope, we were really hands-on as far as meeting with the principals, going on their walkthroughs through the schools here and there to make sure that we're meeting one-on-one with the principals to see what the needs are. We have tips in our area that some of those funds can be allocated for things if needed. So I think that even though that we don't have a say, and the alderman itself doesn't have a say, and you know, who works there and the budget, we do have resources that can be allocated for those
schools. Ms. Guajardo.
A few things. I agree with the LLC. Also, this is my second year on the local school council at March and Elementary School, my daughter's attend. Parent involvement, I believe, is even more important to ensure that parents have a voice and that they're expressing their voice, because the role of the LLC members is to actually listen to what the needs are of the community. So sometimes we forget as LLC members and not listen to what is actually needed. The other thing is investment in the schools. Look at our community, our local schools here in the community. Go to the north side, look at where the funding's going. Look at the difference in the services that the schools receive.
So it has to be a reinvestment in our community schools. And in Alva Gardens, you don't have a high school. It is not right for your students to be coming outside of the community to look for a high school. We need to make sure that we invest in our community and have the proper services that we need when it comes to education.
Mr. Sanchez.
As anti-violence coordinator for Alliance of the Southeast, I've worked to actually reinvest $3.2 million back into our schools for restorative justice programming so schools can define safety in their own way and making sure that our students are well equipped with mental health services themselves and support services. Alongside this, I will advocate for an elected school board to make sure that people in school can actually vote on how the budget's being passed for CPS, because the people who are paying the taxes deserve to say how schools are run, especially when it comes to the budget. What I will say in my final point is making sure at the end of the day, I, and as an LSC member for George Washington High School, created a green new school committee because our school is falling down, and I spoke with Robert Peters, Senator Robert Peters, to ensure we have funding at the state level, and it's insecure. Thank you.
This is Venegas.
So as an alderman, I will be working with the LSC members to make sure to help them navigate and fight for the resources that they need, attending regular LSC meetings, meeting regularly with the principals, so that we can work together to fight the school board if needed, to get the resources that they need for their specific school. So basically working with the community, the parents, the principals, and helping guide them through the system, helping them understand how to advocate for themselves and for their schools.
For the next question, we are going to ask you to address a question from the audience. This is going to be a short one, so we'll go with 30 seconds. What will you do to keep General Iron out of the 10th Ward to protect the public's health? 30 seconds, Mr. Chico. Let's start with Ms. Guajardo.
30 seconds. Transparency. At the moment, General Iron is, I believe there's support, it's not allowed to open. But we have to make sure that we have transparency, that we educate our community about the environmental effects of our company. While it's important to bring in jobs in the community, we have to make sure that we have jobs that do not kill us, do not hurt our or affect us on our environment. Community involvement. Very important for our community to not just to be educated, but to be involved in the process of the corporations that come into our community.
Mr. Sanchez.
Yes.
I'd say that we need a community impact ordinance, that we have to take into consideration the current operations happening in an area before there's even a permit issued at the state, local, or even city level. And top of this, it's making sure that we're looking at our communities, because we have the highest respiratory and cancer rates, and we have one of the lowest air quality in the state of Illinois, and we need people to actually say that they're against General Iron, because they were going to kill us with the environmental pollution. Thank you.
Ms. Venegas.
As Ms. Carter said, that there's a legal case right now prohibiting them from coming to our neighborhood right now. Actually, the legal system, as an attorney, it's like the legal system is one very forceful way to fight against these companies coming to our neighborhood and polluting our neighborhood. More importantly, I want to understand what I would want to vet the company, the business, and check to see how it's going to impact our community, good or bad, and then evaluate that and assess it that way.
Ms. Carreón.
I think it's very important, like I mentioned, we need to get more community involvement, educate our community, educate them on the pros and cons of these companies coming in, and making sure that our voices are being heard and presenting ourselves at these only meetings, and making sure that we're being loud enough with our concerns. And that's how we're going to be able to counter that.
Mr. Chico.
I think we need community involvement when it comes to bringing in companies and jobs. It's very important. We need transparency on both ends. to ensure that what we have coming in, the community buys and it will be used.
Thank you. Before we move on to the next question, just for clarification, because it's been asked, each candidate will have 90 seconds at the end for a closing statement and to address any additional items that they thought they would have liked to expand upon or add to after the questions. Second of all, if someone would like to ask questions during this part of the program, please write your questions if you can on a form, on a card. There are cards at the front. And if there's time, we'll take some time for questions from the floor. Also, to the extent possible, candidates will make themselves available for one-on-one questions after we're done. The next question has to do with the topic that has been touched upon several times during the answers today, and that is the CTA Red Line extension, which will have a 130th Street termination at all adult gardens. And it's going to bring a lot of new opportunities for residents of the area. For each candidate, please tell us how you see your involvement in the commercial development that the extension hopefully will stimulate. And also, how will you ensure that the retail opportunities that are created remain affordable? 45 seconds. We'll start with Ms. Carreón. I'm sorry, we'll start with Mr. Sanchez.
When it comes to the Red Line expansion, it's a great opportunity, but we have to be honest about how it can also be displacing our community members. So we need to be working at the state level to create rent control and make sure that our community members can be here prospering. There's going to be an investment here to make sure that people are well equipped to have these jobs, be able to have co-ops to be owning some of these retail stores, because we want to build generational wealth for Elkdale Gardens, for Golden Gate, for Riverdale. It's not just Golden, it's not just Elkdale Garden. We have to say very specifically, it is over 8,000 community members that need to have a share of the pie and not just the crops.
Venegas.
Thank you for as far as ensuring that it's a housing impacting community, obviously we run for the city, ensuring, understanding what their plan is, what the actual details of their plans are, and ensuring that they are not harming our neighborhoods, especially here. And this is to our board, Elkdale Gardens. So we want to make sure that it's not harming and it's beneficial to us. We want to make sure that these retail services are, as someone said, there's business owners in the neighborhood. The helpful is that someone from our neighborhood can be one of the retail, right, one of the retail services. So working with the community to address with the community, working with the city, finding out exactly what their plan is, and advocating to make sure that there's nothing harmful to our community.
Ms. Carter.
I think the first thing is we need to definitely sit down with the community and see what the needs are of the community, what the community wants. With the Red Line extension, I see it being a positive thing, providing short-term and long-term jobs, making sure that they know that they need to hire locally and pushing for that. There are many candidates in the area for these job opportunities, so we need to make sure that those are that is a priority, is to be able to make sure that those jobs are being taken by our community. And as far as businesses, I would like to see more mom and pop, more small shops, more incubators, shared space. We in the past we've done shared spaces in the South Chicago area where we started businesses from the bottom all the way to where they were able to move into their own brick and mortar. So we'd love to continue doing that, and that we need to provide free business workshops in the community to let people know that they know how to.
Well, I'm excited about the extension. We can finally celebrate what we have here. Elkdale Gardens is a historic place. A couple months ago, I see some people in the room, we were at the Tug Farm site, an underground railroad site that was given historic landmark status. We can celebrate that. Well, how about employing people here at Elkdale Gardens, Section 3, for CHA residents own businesses here and employ the people here.
Ms. Guajardo.
So one of the first things I would love to do is do a community needs assessment of the entire 10th Ward. Every community is different. All the gardens have certain needs. Other parts of the 10th Ward has several different needs. If we have a better understanding of what our community needs, then that's how we're able to look for those services. It's great that we're having the resident extension, but it's to ensure that these are local jobs and that the businesses that come up, we've incubated worker co-ops in the 10th Ward. Two women-led co-ops and three more that are on their way to be launched. Next, make sure that we provide the resources to the residents here who are currently entrepreneurs, give them the resources they need so they can be able to take on these jobs and hire other people locally.
Next question, this is a question from the audience, and we'll take 45 seconds for each speaker. What are you going to do to support CHA residents who are business owners and the low-income Section 3 business population as a whole? What can you say that speaks to this population? We start with Ms. Venegas.
So, as all communities, we have different concerns. Some things we carry on. One thing that I want to do to help businesses is we do have retail stores, but what may be needed is service providers. You want, just like we talked about, like mental health facilities. We get therapy here. I was talking about people want veterinarians. Combine the business avenues so that people come for services, now they're spending money on retail services, and it should help the businesses all around. So while there's different concerns for different communities, that one kind of carries over a little bit more. But I would want to hear from the community for what services you would want.
Ms. Carreón.
So as a business owner, I know how difficult it is to go through the process of applying for a business. It's a lot of loops that you have to go through in the city of Chicago. I would want to do quarterly small business workshops, specifically for Section 3 businesses here in Aldermanic. If you use I know that it was $400 million invested to development area. Let's use your area. Let's use your beautiful library space that I've been to many times throughout the pandemic, giving resources of the vaccine and COVID-19 and all. So, very familiar with that, with the library, so I would love to be able to do quarterly workshops there. We'll be even people that just questioning, hey, I think I may have an idea here. Let's get that idea on paper and take them all the way through.
Mr. Chico.
As I just mentioned, in Section 3, you will find no bigger advocate for Section 3 than me. This is how the residents of the Altdale Gardens are going to take control of the neighborhood by having businesses, employing people from here, and taking ownership of where you live. So I'll be an advocate for you, and I will connect you as best I can.
Ms. Guajardo.
Well, back to the previous question, doing a community needs assessment. What is it that the community needs? And then from there, we're able to figure out the resources. When we started incubating these two worker co-ops, one of them was a community co-op. We had to go to the city of Chicago. City of Chicago closed the doors on the women. Why? Because they did not know. They could not identify what a worker co-op, which is a small business. It's important that these City of Chicago officials or other folks understand what these businesses are, but more importantly, for us to ensure that we provide the resources. A lot of our women who started these co-ops did not needed the basic skills to be able to start up with businesses. So they can make sure that we have those resources for these individuals who want to start up these businesses so they can be able to process.
Mr. Sanchez.
Very obvious that CHA doesn't meet with us. It doesn't meet with any communities, from Germano Millgate, from Jeffrey Manor, Bush. It doesn't meet with Aldermanic Gardens. And I think it's most important to make sure management companies are listening and understanding and making the decisions based off what community members are saying. Because let's raise our hands. Did any of you have input? Did any of you give input about the security company that then replaced APG? Raise your hand if you did. You didn't. It's about making sure they do have the decision and what's impacting your community, as well as the businesses here, and making sure, and it's even a question I want you to ask these candidates, how many of you support affordable housing, and making sure that your housing is a right here, because we don't want to displace people, making sure we uplift this community and its economy. We cannot be displacing its members.
Ms. Guajardo.
So,
second, 45 seconds. As an alderman, how will you implement or promote initiatives to clean up years and years of soil contamination and reduce pollution coming from the nearby industrial areas and landfills? And we start with Ms. Carreón.
So I think it's a matter of sitting down with these company owners in the industries and making sure, holding them accountable for their for the pollution. There are rules in place, and I believe that if we were strict with our environmental state laws and city laws, then we need to just make sure we enforce those. Again, meeting regularly with them, making sure that we're meeting with the community. If there's any concerns with the community, addressing those concerns and staying on top of them, making sure that we're holding them accountable.
I'm going to ask you the question again. As an alderman, how will you implement or promote initiatives to clean up years and years of soil contamination and reduce pollution coming from the nearby industrial areas and landfills? Mr. Chico.
This is where environmental justice is born. The Johnson family did so much work. They saw an injustice in the community and they took action. Like a question we just asked earlier, we need to re-implement the Office of Environment, because then we can work with the mayor's office to clean up what's going on now. And as Ms. Johnson referred to, this is a toxic donut. We're going to stop these businesses from coming in here and polluting our area.
Ms. Guajardo.
Before coming here, I did some research and looked at the Chicago Health Atlas, and I saw in the river that we made, because unfortunately, Alder Garden doesn't have any, there hasn't been any studies on the cancer. Unfortunately, a lot of these companies are causing increasing rates of cancer in Riverdale. Unfortunately, it's been up to 5 times as much of cancer rate for the entire city of Chicago. Our people are dying in our communities. We need to make sure that these companies that are here and the new ones that will be coming and for the laws that we currently have are enforceable. It's important that we do not continue to contaminate and kill our residents in the community. Education is key to make sure that the residents know what companies are coming and that they also have an input to make a decision whether they're okay or not with these companies arriving here. But it's very important, as a sister who just asked, I just asked my sister a few months ago from cancer, and just looking at the number of cancer rate is not okay for what's happening in our communities and how we're disposable.
Mr. Sanchez.
So when it comes to the data that comes here, I'm proud to say that I've been able to be somebody who worked on trying to connect. That we're the ones that did the studies in the Cannon River on seeing the cancer rates and respiratory issues. But the city didn't tell us that Aldo Garden would be part of this plan. But if they were, we would do that study to make sure, because we have the highest amount of respiratory issues and cancer rates, one of the lowest air qualities in the state of Illinois. That is not acceptable. My grandfather, the doctor looked at us and said, your grandfather's gonna die because he has weak lungs, and walked away. That is not acceptable. When it comes to us, it's community impact ordinance, Department of Environment, making sure that we look at the zoning and land use and also go back to our community and say, what should this look like? Because it's your decision, it's your home, and it's your lives that are being impacted. Thank you.
Ms. Venegas.
So, I agree.
I want
to go
with
EAP. I want to make sure that they are enforcing all the rules regulating the environmental aspects of these companies, making sure that we have to implement higher fines, and these fines that will go towards cleanup. Working with the city hall, looking to try to work on increasing a budget for our area. For our area, and specific to the cleanup of these lands. So working with there and making sure that we have accountability to the companies.
A question from the audience, 45 seconds. Chicago has the most lead service lines of any major city, but so far, Chicago has only replaced 300 lines. How will you, as alderman, work with the mayor's office to speed up this process and ensure that our communities have clean drinking water? Mr. Chico.
So in every other major city where they're doing this, that their cost is so much cheaper. complain how expensive this is. But the way we're doing it is expensive. We can cut down the cost of care if we take the new approach that Newark is taking in other cities. We can speed it up, it'll be cheaper, and we can finally see a growth in this. 300 has been done out of thousands. That's unacceptable.
Ms. Guajardo.
So we had our Vice President Harris come to the 10th floor to talk to us about a new investment in the community. Let's use those fundings, ensure that City Hall is able to advocate, and remove the current pipes that we have to replace new ones. The entire 10th ward needs to replace with the new pipes. We need to have community involvement to make sure that the community is having an input in the say of how the funding should be allocated in our community.
Mr. Sanchez.
400,000 lead service lines. I need you to think about that number and think about how many we've replaced these past 2 years. People are dying from lead poisoning and having health impacts from this. We need to work with the Department of Transportation, Department of Planning and Development. We need to work with the Department of Water Management. I went to Newark, New Jersey, talked to Ironbound community that's looking at this at the front lines of how do we make this change. And what we have to do, work at replacing them at a block level and look at replacing them at a full service. The City of Chicago says that they don't own the full service line. We have to make sure that they own all of it. That's what they're doing in Newark, New Jersey. We have to look at the examples of our leaders and this EJ movement and make sure that we have free and clean drinking water. Thank you.
Ms. Venegas.
I
would
want to assess the plan. Talk to the mayor. What exactly the plan is. Look at the details of how they're implementing these changes. I want to look at that plan, assess it, check a line-by-line budget, see where that money's going, how it's allocated, look at the company, work with them, check, maybe to outsource another expert, get a second opinion on what's going on with this plan and the construction of these pipe replacement, and work on it and see about advocating for them to change the plan and improve that plan so that it would be expedited.
Just like everyone mentioned here, we definitely need to find funding and allocate those funds to be able to change the pipes immediately. I believe that we need to start pushing to get the water tested and see whose water and what areas are being affected the most, because I can guarantee you that we're right there on top, and start changing those immediately. In the meantime, I think short term, we need to offer grants and opportunities for homeowners to be able to apply for filters for their homes in the meantime. We can't just wait till our pipes get changed and just continue drinking the water or using the water. So that's a short-term plan that if you need to find funding and allocate those funds to be able to offer filters and services like that for these homeowners.
We have some remaining questions from the audience. Thank you. First question, you take on 30 seconds for each candidate. How will you stop gentrification from happening in this area? Ms. Guajardo.
Investment locally. We need to invest in our communities to make sure that our communities can remain here. It goes back again to the whole situation. You look at the City of Chicago where there's been displacement in the community. How do you make sure that our communities are able to stay in their homes, that they have the job that they need to be able to pay their taxes, so we don't continue to lose our residents? And so investing locally in jobs, making sure that our residents are able to pay them to have affordable housing.
Mr. Sanchez.
African Americans in the City of Chicago, one of the largest populations that left the City of Chicago. And we have to be verbal and honest about this. We need to actually have opportunities for all the community members to ensure that they're not going to be displaced. Again, it's advocating at the state level to have rent control to make sure that people aren't displaced, but also looking at increasing entrepreneurs, small businesses. There's funding right now to equip our community members to have these protections by having them be the owners of all these developments. When it's community owned, it's going to make sure they're safe.
Ms. Venegas.
So, bottom line is we want to make sure that everyone here is in the right in order to avoid gentrification, having being moved out of your neighborhood. We want to make sure that
businesses, incubators, share space. We need to empower our residents.
You can let her finish the sentence.
I'm sorry.
30 seconds, another question for the audience.
Finish the sentence.
As a resident.
I got one more, employment. We employ people, they have the power to do whatever they want. We need to connect people from all the gardens to the real world. Transportation needs to improve. Putting businesses here, I know right here, we have people that want to work, that want to do a job to provide for their families. We're going to connect them to employment.
Next question from the audience, also 30 seconds. How will you engage with the CHA population and get more resources to improve the quality of life for these families? Mr. Sanchez.
For me, it's bringing you back to community decision-making practices. I've already been working with people for community recovery about establishing land use, zoning, and community decision-making. And for me, it's about having advisors, not only a youth advisor for youth to vision their future here, but also our seniors, for them to have a say, because oftentimes they're the ones most forgotten, especially right now when we're thinking about grocery stores. Seniors are promised the transportation to grocery stores, but when was the last time a bus picked up seniors to go to a grocery store? We need to make sure we have follow-up on these concerns.
Ms. Venegas.
So one of the things that I'm looking to do as a whole, and I think it still could work here with Alcohol Garden as well, is to develop youth programs. The young need positive activities for their life, not just the children, but the young adults. Young adults need guidance on how to choose what they want to do with their lives. Some might want to go to college, and that's great, but if college isn't for them, we want to guide them in their opportunity, in their options of trade schools and other options that they have to join the workforce and become, and guide their lives in a positive direction. So that's how I would want to improve the resources for the
outdoor gardens. Just repeating the question and request of one of the candidates. What is your plan to engage the CHA population and help with more resources to improve the quality of life for these families? Next is Ms. Carreón.
So when I worked at the board office, one of the things that we did is when Jeffrey Manor and even Geronimo Milky were getting to the board, one of their main concerns was predominantly African American in their communities, and we are predominantly Latino ward. They were worried their voices were going to be not heard. So one of the things that we did, we went out there, we met with the community leaders, walked the area, walked the development, and went into even apartments and heard hands on what the community concerns were. That's exactly what I was doing here. Come out here, meet with the residents, hear the concerns, and hope we can get
them. Fair enough.
I'm sorry.
Go to CHA here. A lot of complaints were cleanliness, safety. I'm sure it's no different than Alcohol Gardens. I am going to wait to have the CHA here to meet with you and discuss these issues, because you should not be forgotten about. That's what I'll do.
Ms. Guajardo.
Again, it goes back to what I said earlier, having a community needs assessment, understanding what are the needs of the community. Whether it's jobs, how do we tackle the needs of jobs? How do we get the union to come into the school to provide scholarships, like spaceships or services like they're doing in our building? We're building a community center in the 10th Ward, and you have the unions who are bringing their apprenticeship to do the work. If we can partner with the schools, but first, also one of the things that I'm hearing, you don't have a high school here in the community. If we're able to bring in a high school, use the space that's open on building C, have local schools bring in these tradesmen, then you can provide these jobs. That's one of the needs that I've been hearing as I've been going out here.
For the last audience questions for now, I'm going to combine several related questions, and if there's time, we have time to give each candidate 45 seconds to address these. So Phil, please feel free to address all of them, or single out one. Someone mentioned that we've talked a lot about the food desert,
but for us residents is safety. Young kids with guns sticking up residents because they're trying to feed their siblings. Related, what are plans to make it keep Osgill Gardens families safe? What will be done to clean up Osgill Gardens? As a resident of Osgill Murray Homes, how can we be sure that if elected, you will not forget about us? 45 seconds, and we'll start with Mr. Venegas. Ms. Venegas.
Jobs Act, making sure that we have good union-paying jobs right here for all of us.
and making sure community outreach, community decision-making, making sure again and again, we're always talking to the community about evaluating the services here, and especially our security management company, making sure they walk around, talk to you, counseling, we can do this.
We've come to the point of the evening where each candidate will have an opportunity to give a closing statement, 90 seconds each. And since we started in alphabetical order, we'll end in reverse alphabetical order. So the first speaker will be Ms. Venegas. 90 seconds.
So as I said before, I've always been giving back to the community. That's my passion, to give back to the community. That's why I'm running for alderman. As a police officer, I wasn't just out there apprehending criminals. That's not just what we do. I advocate for victims. I help them find their resources. I love to help the people. That's what I love to do. As an attorney, I love representing my clients, helping them through the legal system, helping them navigate and negotiate their contracts. I want to help people. That's why I'm trying to run. That's why I'm running for alderman. And I want to help the community. Now I want to take those experiences, and I want to guide you guys, help you guys, and listen to your concerns, and help build back our 10th ward and our new welcome outgoing gardens into the 10th ward, and bring you guys up and make sure that we can have a thriving community and somewhere where we're happy raising our families. I love that I have my four kids here. I'm raising them, and I have an extended family here that. We're all over the 10th ward, and I love it here, and I think it's a great place to raise our families. And I believe that with the right leadership, we can become a competitive economy again in the 10th ward. So I need your help in order to do that. So Punch 52 on February 28th, will Jessica Venegas. Thank you.
Mr. Sanchez.
I'm here because we have to be honest about our circumstances. The cost of living is going up. We're just not working one job, working multiple jobs. And for what? We need real economic opportunity here and throughout the 10th Ward. People are suffering. People are scared to go outside the doors. And I can't stand that. We have to be honest, and I want to say this, it's a 30-year life expectancy difference between the north side and the south side. We have to be honest that they still have to stop saying just Alkill Gardens. It's over 8,000 people that were here trying to service. For me, it's all making sure that it's a safe, healthy, thriving community for all of us. Because it's not enough to say that we want to do this. We have to be intentional about our budgets. We can't have a wish list. It's also asking each of these candidates, what is your ideal budget and how you can ensure that we're not displacing people by investments here, ensuring that people will live, going people to go outside to play with their kids. The greatest thing I've seen here when I've been door knocking is seeing children playing outside. It's one of the most beautiful sounds. But think about more. Think about a thriving business district here where people come to Alkill Gardens, where public transportation isn't just to connect us to the city, but to connect the city to this beautiful place right here. Our greatest asset is the people, and we must strengthen the people by investing in the people. Thank you.
Please hold your questions. Ms. Guajardo.
Be real. For so many years, people of color, Latinos, African Americans, and other minorities have been living in communities that have been disinvested for many years. Still can't leave our community, and we're left for nothing. It is unfair for us to continue to fight for crumbs that are given to us in our community. We need to make sure that we have a strong voice and presence in City Hall to bring the resources that we need in our community. I'm a mother of two daughters and 10 CPS, and I am afraid for their safety. We need to make sure that we have fully funded schools and safe neighborhoods. We need to make sure that public safety is lifted, not in one part of the community, but the entire ward. We're dealing with two police districts. Let's make sure that we build that relationship with the trust, the police officers, and our community members. Let's make sure that we invest, not disinvest in our community. We need to take proactive stances, not be reactive to what comes to us. As we work together, unite as communities, communities of color, people who have been disinvested for many years, I'm running for office because I am tired of the dirty politics that we constantly have. And we need to make sure that we hold politicians, including whoever takes the seat, accountable for the decisions that they make.
So I'm running for Alderman because I feel I have the experience when it comes to safety. I'm Chicago police officers. I work in a 4th district that encompasses 90% of the board. And just today alone, I was in the 5th district, meeting with them, figuring out their game issues and talking about how we're going to solve that. I have the experience. When it comes to education, I've been on the school board the last 4 years, where we made enormous decisions on the youth. And I have the experience. It's about experience and what you've done with it. We can get up here and say what we think, what we're going to do, but it comes down to our life experience. I've dealt with at-risk youth at Maryville Academy and Children's Shelter, and being a caseworker at DCFS Children. I know what goes on. I'm proud of my experience. I'm proud of my background. And I'm going to take that to the residents of the Temple Ward.
Thanks.
Carry
on.
Yes, I agree with that. This is about experience. And I am the only candidate that has 9 years of experience in that Aldermanic office. I have experience with safety. I have worked directly with the 4th District, with the police in the Indiana, in the Burnham area, in Lansing, working together to make sure that we realize that we all have the same problems, same issues, and we need to work together. As far as business economic development, that is one of my main focus. I worked with UIC to come up with a revitalization plan that has been sitting there since 2015, not being put to use. And my plan is to put that revitalization plan to use and make sure that we build our economic business districts. Because when we build our business districts, that's when we're gonna get more pedestrian traffic. We're gonna get more attention from our police department, and the safety issue will be addressed as well. As far as the youth, I have experience with bringing youth programs. I brought, we were able to work with the Shakespeare in the Park to make sure that our youth had a platform to perform and showcase what they have to offer. We have so much talent in this area. The arts is my passion, and I want to make sure that we bring more programs to our youth to make sure to get them off the street and get them working on their passions, their using their minds, making these programs available for them. That's what I offer. I offer experience in that office. I'm ready to work day one, and that's why I'm running for Test Board Alderman.
We have 5 great candidates. They've given us a lot of time, and they've given us their best answers.